はい。でも帰って帰って帰って帰って帰って帰って帰って
slides, which actually were created by a fellow named Dan Sanders, and I saw this presentation about a year and a half ago in McAllen, Texas, and Dan used to be the our operations director, and now has started a church in Houston, and but I thought it was a very intense understanding of full gospel businessmen's roots, because he traced it all the way back to the apostles. Actually, they were the first full gospel businessmen. Weren't they? They were businessmen, right? And so, before, though, I share this, the Lord put it on my heart that I want you to pray for a couple of guys that normally would have been here today, because they've always been here over the years. Rick Byers and Gary Abbott.
Amen.
And both of these men are under attack, you might say, physically. They're both in the same nursing facility in Lenexa, Kansas. Rick, about 3 months ago, went under brain surgery to have a tumor, a cancerous tumor removed from his brain. And the doctors haven't given him any hope, but we're standing on the Word of God, and so is he. And when I went to visit him the first time, he was in Columbia at the University Hospital. And as I was driving from Kansas City to Columbia, the Holy Spirit told me to remind Rick that he's a Marine.
Mm-hmm.
When you get there, remind him he's a Marine. And then share with him the story of the centurion. And how the centurion went to Jesus and for a servant. And Jesus said, "I'll come." And he said, "No, you don't have to. I'm not even worthy, you come. I'm a man of authority, and I say something and people follow what I say, and somebody else says something and I follow what they say. I understand authority. All you have to do is speak the word."
Yes.
And Jesus said, "Man, I've never seen anybody like this in all of Israel. What faith." So we're just going to speak the word of God over Rick Byers, and just claim that what Jesus accomplished on the cross is going to be manifested tangibly in his body.
Amen.
Jesus bore his sin and his body on the tree, and he's dead to sin, alive unto righteousness, and by his stripes Rick was healed. Father, we just give you all the praise and glory for that. In Jesus' name. Gary Abbott has been suffering with, I guess it's described as Alzheimer's, and it's been progressing and so forth, but I saw him just last week, and he is on fire for God. Mm-hmm. I mean, he is, seriously, I mean, he would be here if he could. And again, we're looking for a miracle. And his wife, Shelley, you know how much faith she has, those of you that have met her. She's standing right alongside of him, and they're here in the spirit right now. So, Father, we just give you the glory for Gary's complete and total recovery and the testimony that he'll have. And he'll be out to sharing that all over the country and the world, as he's done in the past.
Amen.
Thank you, Father, for manifesting a new miracle in his life, just like the first miracle you manifested in his life when he first came into a full gospel chapter many years ago. He was in Wilmington, North Carolina. He had a terrible back problem. He couldn't straighten it. It was in a plate in his back and so forth. And he didn't even know anything about full gospel. They prayed for him, and he had complete healing right there in the meeting. So Gary knows that God moves when someone prays. So, Father, we just give you praise and glory and honor for both of these guys. We love them, and you're in control of their lives, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. I printed up a handout that you can make more copies of off the internet if you want, because I downloaded it. It's a PDF that's on the internet, Vision Intensified. This booklet is the last booklet that Demas wrote before he went to be with the Lord. He left 1993 in July, and he wrote this sometime in either late 92 or early 93. It is powerful, it's anointed, it's something you want to read over and over and over, and you'll watch what the Holy Spirit will do and stir you up. It's referenced many times during this slide presentation, as well as the book Happiest People on Earth. How many have read this book? This was the original book. We've got several copies back there if you need a copy. And you haven't read it, please feel free to take it. I brought a few copies then for that purpose. Another book that was written about a year or so ago was by Demas's granddaughter, called The Shakarian Legacy. Cynthia wrote this, and I've told people that if you never met Demas Shakarian and you read this book, you would feel like you knew him personally. It's actually Voice Magazine on steroids.
That's amazing.
She went out and interviewed people all over the world, or they sent testimonies to her, people that had their original platforms, you might say, in full gospel years ago, the Jerry Duplantis's, the Kenneth Copelands, people like that. And so they share their testimonies throughout the book. So that's something else you might want to consider. Now, there's a couple of copies back there of that. If you would like to pick up a copy, feel free to. All right. This slide, A New Wave, we haven't seen anything yet. God's vision is going to intensify and increase in power. I'm going to take you back to, in a sense, the beginning through and just kind of share, just more or less walk you through the slides. And those of you in chapters, if you want to get a copy of this presentation later, we'll email it to you, and you can share it with your group, okay, or your chapter, I should say. Demas was quoted in an earlier book that he read, sometimes to make a great advance requires going back to the beginning. So we're going to use a lot of scriptures as our foundation here, because we're full gospel businessmen and we belong to an international fellowship. So in Philippians it says, I'm sure of this, that he who started a good work in you will carry it on completion until the day of Christ Jesus. And it says, he says in the first page of this booklet, to fully grasp the spiritual dynamics of what God is going to do in the future, it's first absolutely vital that you spiritually understand what God has already done through our fellowship and the explosive power of His Holy Spirit. Our spiritual roots, step by step, in the coming months, I will share with you the mighty move God intends for His prepared people. There is so much I want to tell you, but God has not yet released me to reveal it. You must first allow the Holy Spirit to minister to you about our spiritual roots. This is like almost the last page of the booklet, and he never got an opportunity to do that because he went home to be with the Lord a few months after he wrote that. So this is really the kind of the platform where the Holy Spirit can stir you up as to what he wants to, what Demas maybe could have said going forward. The Holy Spirit's going to reveal that to you personally. So Jesus is the central to who we are and what we do. Would you agree? He is our foundation, our spiritual roots. So we're going to step through, get our focus refocused on Jesus and what the Word says about Jesus. Today in the city of David, a Savior was born for you, who is the Messiah, and the Lord. There's three words there that we're going to emphasize. Jesus was born into this world with three purposes: Savior, Messiah, and Lord. Okay? Jesus is our Savior. Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, right? There is a salvation in no one else, there is no other name under heaven given to people by which they must be saved. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many, Jesus is our Savior. Jesus is the Messiah. He brings the kingdom of God. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to preach the good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, a recovery of sight to the blind, to set at free the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And then when John, sent the disciples to Jesus, when John was in prison, they asked, Are you the one who is to come, or should we expect someone else? And Jesus replied to them, go and report to John what you hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, those with leprosy are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead raised, the poor are told the good news. Praise God. Now Jesus is Lord, all-powerful, all-knowing, everywhere present. God replied to Moses, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent me to you. Jesus said to them, truly, I tell you, before Abraham was, I am. There's seven additional times Jesus claims to be I am in the Gospel of John. Lord equals what? Right of command. Jesus and the Holy Spirit. You know, Jesus was a man, right? He was just a human being. And all the things that he didn't do because he was God. We're all on the page, right? He was not an example for us. He was an example of us. Mm-hmm. He was to demonstrate God in man, literally. And we were to do the same things that he did, even more so. Mm-hmm. So it's not he that did it, it's the Holy Spirit with him that equipped him to do it. The same Holy Spirit that equips us to do the same things that he did. Mm-hmm. We all agree on that? Because mm-hmm. that is so foundational. That is so bedrock. Jesus was filled with the Holy Spirit. When all the people were baptized, Jesus was also baptized. As he was praying, heaven opened and the Holy Spirit descended on him in a physical appearance like a dove. Jesus was led by the Holy Spirit. Then Jesus left the Jordan full of the Holy Spirit and was led by the Spirit in the wilderness. Jesus announces his mission. The kingdom of God is near. Kingdom equals rule and reign of God. The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news, what Jesus said. Emphasizing the word repent there. We've religiousized this word to a great deal. And most of us don't even know what the word means. But if you go to the Greek and translate it, what it means is something maybe a challenge to you. It simply means to change the way you think. That's literally what the word means. What was Jesus saying? Change the way you think. Believe what I'm saying. Just change the way you think. Because the way you've been thinking is wrong. You need to think as I speak. You need to think the words that I say. You know, believe what I say. Repent. Change the way you think. And believe the good news, the gospel. Okay? Being asked by the Pharisees when the kingdom of God would come, he answered them, the kingdom of God is not coming with some observable thing. No one will say, see here or there, or see, for you see, the kingdom of God is within you. Okay? Jesus calls, recruits or invite, disciples or followers. That's starting up chapters. When daylight came, he summoned his disciples and he chose 12 of them, whom he'd also named apostles. Simon, whom he also named Peter, and Andrew, his brother, James and John, Philip and Bartholomew, Matthew and Thomas, James the son of Alphaeus, and Simon called the Zealot, Judas the son of James, and Judas Iscariot, who became a traitor. Kind of underlined a couple of names there because those two people end up in Armenia. In fact, 10 years after Jesus ascends into heaven, Judas the son of James, called Thaddeus, is in Armenia. So, what's coming out of Armenia eventually? Full gospel business with Fellowship International, actually, because that's where our roots were, right? Okay. Jesus teaches disciples in the Gospel of John, chapters 14, 15, and 16, five major topics, which are really the core of full gospel. Number one, personal relationship with God. It's covered 12 times. Love for God and each other. That's covered 12 times. The Holy Spirit, 8 times. Obedience, 7 times. Prayer, 7 times. Jesus sends out his disciples to do his work. Summoning the 12, he gave them power and authority over all demons and to heal diseases. Then he sent them to proclaim the kingdom of God and to heal the sick. After this, the Lord appointed 72 others, and he sent them ahead of them in pairs into every town and place where he himself was about to go. Heal the sick who are there and tell them the kingdom of God has come near you. Note, what are they instructed to do? They are instructed to what? heal diseases, cast out demons, and proclaim the kingdom of God. What are we instructed to do? Heal the sick, cast out demons, and proclaim the kingdom of God to the businessman and woman. Jesus commissions and empowers the disciples. This is, he says this right at the end of Luke's gospel, just before he ascends into heaven. Okay? Jesus says, this is what is written. The Messiah would suffer and rise from the dead the third day, and repentance and forgiveness of sins would be proclaimed in his name to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and look, I am sending you what my Father promised. As for you, stay in the city until you are empowered from on high. And Matthew says, Jesus says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe everything I have commanded you. Disciples receive the Holy Spirit. Pentecost. Suddenly, a sound like that of a violent rushing wind came from heaven, and it filled the whole house where they were staying. Then they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in different tongues as the Spirit enabled them. And then Peter goes up and teaches. This is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. And it will be in the last days, says God, that I will pour out my Spirit on all people. Then your sons and daughters will prophesy. I will even pour out my Spirit on my servants in those days, both men and women, and they will prophesy. So Jesus passed on to the 12 what was meant to be passed on to us also. Jesus said in John, truly I tell you, the one who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and you will do even greater works than these, because I'm going to the Father. And the disciples are scattered to the nations. On the day a severe persecution broke out against the church of Jerusalem, and all except the apostles were scattered throughout the land of Judea and Samaria. Now those who had been scattered as a result of the persecution that started because of Stephen made their way to far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, speaking the word to no one except Jews. But there were some of them, men from Cyprus and Cyrene, who came to Antioch and began speaking to the Greeks also, proclaiming the good news about the Lord Jesus. Two of Jesus' disciples traveled to Armenia. This is recorded in a book that was written called The Search of the 12 Apostles. The first illuminators of Armenia were St. Thaddeus and St. Bartholomew. A popular tradition amongst them ascribes the first evangelization of Armenia to the apostles Judas Thaddeus, who was, according to their chronology, spent the years 43 through 66 anti domino after the in the year of our Lord in that country, and was joined by St. Bartholomew in the year 60. Well, year 43, Jesus leaves when he's 33. That's 10 years later after Jesus goes to heaven. These guys, this one apostle shows up in Armenia. Abgar of Edessa, Armenia, is claimed to be one of the first Christian kings in history, having been converted to the faith by Thaddeus, the apostle. And that's recorded in the Catholic Encyclopedia, most recent version, 1913. Just kidding. Armenia becomes the first Christian nation through St. Gregory the Illuminator. Gregory was actually had you can read about it in the booklet there. It'll touch on it, but he was thrown into a pit for 13 years, and the king just figured he was dead, and then the king had a problem and he needed some help. Somebody said, hey, Gregory can help you, and he can't be alive. And sure enough, he was still alive. By the grace of God, so they bring him out of the pit. Gregory was eventually called forth from his pit in 297 to restore sanity to write it. Tiridates the third. In 301, Gregory baptized Tiridates the third among with members of the royal court. Tiridates the third issued a decree by which he granted Gregory full rights to begin carrying out the conversion of the entire nation to the Christian faith. After the Middle Ages, Reformation, outpouring of the Holy Spirit, 1833, outpouring of the Holy Spirit in Russia, the Molokans. A portion of the Molokans during this time began to experience a charismatic outpouring of the Holy Spirit. They believed that they were visited by a manifestation of the Holy Spirit and began a revival with intense zeal, reporting miracles that purportedly rivaled those of Christ's apostles. In 1855, the boy prophet, get this name, Efthen Gerasimovich Klubikin. Okay. He's the boy prophet. I think that's why they keep referring to him as the boy prophet. At some unspecified time in the future, the boy wrote, every Christian in Caracalla, that's where Demas's grandfather was living, okay? Great-grandfather, and would be in terrible danger. The time would come from everywhere, everyone must flee. They must go to the land across the sea, but they were not to settle down there, but continue traveling to the west coast. There God would bless them and prosper them and cause their seed to be a blessing to the nations. Now Demas, it wasn't his great-grandfather, it was his grandfather. In fact, his name was Demas as well. So Demas, his grandfather, and then Isaac, his son, and then Demas, the son of Isaac, the son of Demas. That's the chronology there. Outpouring of the Holy Spirit. Demas, his grandfather, the senior, and the steer's head. If you've read the book, Happiest People on Earth, these spirit-filled people came to town, and his grandfather wanted to, impress him with a big meal. So he had this cattle and so forth, and he picked this largest cow, I guess, but he noticed that the cow had a blemish. I mean, one of his eyes he was blind in one eye. And he just knew from enough about Scripture to know, you shouldn't be offering up something to the Lord to do in His name that's blemished. But it was the biggest cow, and it was going to fit, it was enough to, satisfy the need for the meal. So he killed the cow, cut the head off, and put the head in the sack and hid it in the barn under a bunch of straw. And so I figured, who would know? So spirit-filled people show up, and the elder guy begins to pray. Then he stops, and he leaves the room and goes out to the barn and licks and takes this head out from underneath the straw that was hidden and in the sack and brings it back. And, of course, Demas' grandfather is stunned by this. And so it's quoted out of Happiest People on Earth because Demas is telling a story about his grandfather, and his grandfather said, but how did you know? And the guy said, well, God told me. The old man said simply, you still not believe that He speaks to His people today as in the past. The Spirit gave me this word of knowledge for a special reason, that you and your family might believe. You have been resisting the power of the Spirit. Today is the day you will resist no longer.
Love it.
That was for sure. He listened to the white prophet. He packed up his family and he headed away. God was speaking to him. The boy prophet announces time to leave Armenia, but the instructions proved correct. In 1914, a period of unimaginable horror arrived for Armenia. The Turks began the bloody business of driving two-thirds of the population out into the Mesopotamian desert. Over a million men, women, and children died in these death marches, including every inhabitant of Caracalla. Another 500,000 were massacred in their villages. Last Wednesday, in Los Angeles, thousands and thousands of Armenians marched in a peaceful march in honor of the 104th anniversary of this massacre. This is timely. The largest population of Armenians in the United States is in Los Angeles. And it's there prophetically, because the boy prophet said, you are to go to the land across the sea, but you're not to stay there. You're to travel to the west coast of that, and you will prosper there. You can always tell a prophet who's a prophet, what they say comes to pass.
Yes.
Right. Outpouring of the Holy Spirit of America, 1905-1906, the Azusa Street outpouring. Grandfather was walking down San Pedro Street in Los Angeles looking for work, and as he passed a side road called Azusa Street, they stopped shortly. Along with the smell of horses and harness leather came the unmistakable sounds of people praising God in tongues. They had not known that anywhere in the United States were people who worshipped as they did. They returned home. The news of Pentecost had come even to this distant land from across the sea. That's on page 24 of the Happiest People on Earth. The birth of full gospel businessman. December 26, 1952, Demas received the vision of God. As you recall, most of you have heard the vision, but the fellowship started actually a year before. And it started with, I think, 21 people. Oral Roberts was present. It was held at Clifton Cafeteria, and Demons actually expected several hundred people to show up because he was a very successful businessman. He had a lot of connections. He'd run a lot of other meetings before, and he'd been promoting Oral Roberts. I mean, he was well known in the community. He expected several hundred to show up, and 18 showed up, plus himself, plus his wife, plus Oral. So there was 21 people there. And over a period of a year, the group dwindled to, I think there was six less than that by the time a year came by and around. He put money into it. He tried to make it go. He tried to connect with everybody he could. He traveled all over, gave lots of free meals. Not one offering was made, and there was no growth. So in December, his wife says to him, if God's in this, it should multiply, right? Or there should be some sort of a evidence. And he said, you're right. I'm going to lay down on the carpet until I get a word from the Lord. And when he went into his living room, and the power of God just fell upon him, and he fell flat on his face, and he had an out-of-body experience. And God took him around the world and showed him, the situation, which is men are dead, walking alongside of each other, and what they need is life. And he says, my son, the Lord said to my son, what you're going to see next is going to happen very soon. But below me, again, were millions and millions of men. But this time, what a difference. Their eyes shone with joy. The once bound hands, now free, were lifted towards heaven. Asia, Africa, America, everywhere death had turned to life. The chains of bondage had been broken. Praise God. The charismatic revival was about to begin and sweep the country. In the 1960s, 70 million spirit-filled Catholics, all spirit-filled and speaking in tongues, is a very large accomplishment. We are thankful to God that he used FGBMFI as a spiritual seed for this miracle. We also need to face a very stark reality, and that is it's only 1.5% of the world's population at that time. The vision has just begun. That's quoted in the Vision Intensified. It's our turn. We must finish the race. Hebrews says, therefore, since we also have such a large cloud of witnesses surrounding us, let us lay aside every hindrance and the sin that so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that lies before us, keeping our eyes on Jesus, the source and perfecter of our faith. For the joy that lay before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. A cloud of witnesses cheering us on. Last January in Phoenix, at our first formal meeting of USA's Full Gospel Organization, we're standing in line to go into a room to have a session with the leaders. And I'm not going to say this is a vision, but this thought went through my mind so clearly that there was Demas, and there was Richard, and there was Steve, and there was Gene, and there was Ray. These are guys that were all in the fellowship, almost all related to the Shakarian family, but some of them had dysfunctional relationships with each other. But they were there, and they were all praising God together and cheering us on. Because when you get to heaven, there's no memory of everything that went wrong on earth. It's zip. You're in the presence of God, you're in the presence of love. All you can do is love. And there were these guys who were at times they were at odds with each other, all cheering us on together. That's what went through my mind. And I think that's exactly where we're at. That they're up here right now, the people that started this whole thing, they're cheering us on. Amen. It's our turn. We must finish the race. I see a time when God will set apart and release a new mighty outpouring of the Holy Spirit. That's what he's saying in this booklet you're going to read. Today, people need to know the reality of Jesus. Men and women are still alone, bound in spiritual chains. They are hungry for food they have never tasted. They are thirsty for living waters they have never experienced. Beloved, he says, they are searching for an experience from God. Praise God. It's our turn. He, God, only needs vessels who are prepared and willing to obey to set these spiritual captives free. He is not looking for our clever ability, our worldwide organization, or our method of approach to taking the world. He only needs our willingness to hear and obey his will. The Holy Spirit will supply the rest. Those are the spiritual roots that launch this fellowship. And that's the spiritual truth that will take us into the future. Today we are the largest lay ministry of our type in the world. The vision God revealed to me in 1952 is being fulfilled, but it's not over. Let's take our blinders off. We are not done. Hear me on this. God has revealed this as clear to me as he did the original vision in 1952. The Lord God, Jehovah, is ready to explode a new wave of revival in this world, and he wants you prepared to participate in his plan. Would you agree?
Yeah.
All right, so there's a way of making a commitment to this, and that is the last page of his book. I want you to take the handout and go to the back of the, not the very last page, that's just kind of a biography of Demas. But there's a prayer that he writes at the end of the book. And I would like for all of us, with the anointing of the Holy Spirit, just to read this together out loud. Because if you believe it in your heart and you say it with your mouth, it will be to you as you say. Amen? Heavenly Father, join with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you have done through our lives and through the ministry of the fellowship. But whatever has been accomplished today, we now know it's only a glimmer, a glimpse of the future, of what is still to be done through the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we stand ready and willing to serve. We are willing to pray, to fast, and to seek your will in our lives, no matter what the cost. You are Lord, you are Master, and it is you alone we shall serve. Heavenly Father, forgive us if sometimes our eyes have focused on men, on chapters, or on buildings. We ask that you will help us focus only on you, and that your mandate for our lives, we realize you alone are our hope, and without the power of the Holy Spirit, nothing we can do will ever save one solitary soul. Lord, we ask that you use us as vessels to help fulfill your vision. Allow us to minister to those who are alone. Enable us to break the bondage of sin in the lives of our neighbors and in the lives of millions of people around the world. Help us to melt the ice-cold death of Satan from lost souls and transform them into children of light through your saving grace. Lord, we give you all the honor and glory for the revelations you have shown us, and thank you in the name of Jesus Christ for what you are about to do to change the face of this world. Amen. Praise God, right? Amen. So take this back, read it, and reread it. And if you